Hello, welcome to Black Horizons. I'm your host, Hamid Rasheed. On Sunday, May 11th at 3 p.m. at the Halifax Metro Center, the first world championship title fight in the history of Nova Scotia will take place between WBC champion Matthew Saad Mohammed and Louis Pergo of Germany and Cameroon's West Africa. We're very pleased and happy to have on our program today our guest, WBC champion Matthew Saad Mohammed, who is, in addition to being the world light heavyweight champion, is also a member of the American Muslim Missionaries. We'll be talking to, hope to talk to Matthew a little later in the program about your involvement with the American Muslim Missionaries, but before we go into that, Matthew, we'd like to talk to you a bit about your Matthew Mohammed, the boxer. I think our viewers might be interested. We were chatting earlier about how you got into boxing. Perhaps you might, for the benefit of the viewers of the program, just explain how you got involved in boxing in the first instance.
Yes. Well, really, I started off being an orphan. You know, I was an orphan before, and I had a little difficulties really settling down in my younger days as a child. Okay, I didn't know who my parents was. So after getting into trouble, I went to reform school, and then I said to myself I wanted to become a somebody in life. So then that's when I started training in my cell, making bags up out of pants, and after that, you know, I went to a gym, which is a gym that is called the Juniper Gym, and I met a man by the name of Nick Belfiore. He took me through some amateur fights. I had 25 amateur fights. Then I lost about, maybe about two or three.
Right.
And then he said, well, Matthew, you're great, you're good, you know, want you to turn professional.
Right.
So after I turned professional, that's when, you know, things started being pretty good for
right.
me.
Roughly what age would you have been, Matthew, when you started your, when you first got it in your mind that you wanted to become a boxer, when you first started your amateur career? How old would you
have been? Well, I was very young. I would say perhaps maybe around about 16, 15.
Right. And how long after that was it that you turned, that you had your first pro fight?
When I was about 18.
About 18. So
yes.
you started your professional career very
Pretty young yes.
as 18, and your professional record, I understand, to this point is 25-3-2. You've had so that would mean you've had 30 fights, 30 professional
yes.
fights in this point. So you're still a relatively young man. You're the champion, light heavyweight champion. At least you have the WBC portion of the championship. In those 30 fight, that 30 fight career, which has spanned, I guess, an 8-year period,
mm-hmm.
has there been any particular aspect of that 8-year career that has stood out in your mind as a highlight?
Well, I think the most exciting thrill that I've ever gotten in life is when I first won the title from Marvin Johnson in his hometown in Indianapolis. And, you know, when I was raised, I felt all kinds of chills throughout my body, and I really felt good. And I said to myself that after getting this title, that I will never let a man take it from me. And as it stands now, you know, being victorious, I'm still keeping my title.
Right. Now, how many years ago was that when you won the title from Johnson? For people maybe who haven't followed the fight scene closely.
It was last year of 79.
And you've had how many title defenses since then?
Just totaling the third one coming up.
Third defense coming
yes.
up. Now, Johnson, you'll have to excuse me. I'm not the most knowledgeable person when it comes to boxing, but wasn't Johnson also the WBA light heavyweight champion?
He was a WBA. He, when I fought him, he was the WBC World Boxing Council champion until I knocked him out, and then they gave him another title shot, and he fought Victor Glendez, and he knocked out Victor Glendez and became the new WBA champion.
I see. So even when you fought Johnson, the title was split at that point. When Johnson held the WBC title, when you fought him, Glendez had the other half of
other half.
And so then you beat Johnson. Then Johnson in turn went around and beat
Glendez.
Beat Glendez.
Yes.
And so then did you get an opportunity to fight Johnson again?
No, that's at that time, that's when he had already signed up to fight Eddie Gregory.
Right.
For his defense.
Right.
His first defense.
Right, and he lost that fight to Gregory.
He lost that fight, yes.
Had you had planned to fight Johnson, or had he been successful in defeating Gregory, or was your hope that you would then be able to combine the two titles by fighting him?
Johnson had stated to me that he would really like to fight me to clear up his record. I knocked him out twice. I fought him once in Philadelphia, my hometown, then the second time in his hometown,
right,
by knocking him out in the eighth round.
Right.
Okay, so he told me he wanted to fight me after I became a WBC champion. He was ready to unite the title, and this is when he really wanted to come back and prove to the world that he was the best light heavyweight.
I see. So what plans do you have now to get I can see that you're a man of ambition, and I have a sneaky suspicion that you probably won't be happy until you succeed in getting the complete world championship. What plans do you have in mind to do that? Are there any negotiations going? I know you've got to get through this fight first, and we'll come back and talk about that, but assuming you're successful in your fight here this Sunday, what are your plans in terms of trying to get the other half of the world title?
Well, I'm only here for two reasons, and that reason is propagating my faith and becoming the light heavyweight champion. I'm talking about the whole wide world, having the WBA, and as right now, having the WBC championship. Okay, I hope to first fight Gregory because I want to put that title together. I want to show the world that, you know, here I am. You know, I am the man as far as the best light heavyweight in the world. I have to take care of Pergo. I know that come May 11th, and I will. And after that, then perhaps maybe everybody can sit down and, you know, I may go up into heavyweight division. It all depends on how I'm talking, if I'm not really getting hurt in the boxing game.
Right. What role does dollars and politics play in this game? Like when several of the titles now are split, all of the big world titles, the light heavyweight title is currently split. You have a WBA version and a WBC version. In your division, the light heavyweight division, you have the same kind of thing. What role does politics and money play in this kind of thing? Is it all between the fighters in terms of who gets together, or are there other factors that...
Sometimes boxing can be very political, okay, and it has a lot of politics in it. I would say in the case with my last bout with John Conte, here I fought Conte 15 rounds. He was getting the best of me in the beginning of the rounds until I knocked him down in that 14th round. And that's when he was saying that, you know, my corner man was using some type of illegal substance on the gloves. It was getting in his eyes. It was making him blink, you know. But when I fought him, the second time, I was hitting this man with so many punches that when he came out the fourth round, he was still blinking, for those who've seen that fight on television.
Right. Now let's go to this man that you're fighting on Sunday. I guess that's the immediate objective. You want to make sure you get by that fight. And those of us who know anything about fighting know that you got to take it one fight at a time.
Mm-hmm.
It only takes one punch to knock a fighter out.
That's right.
What about this man that you're fighting on Sunday, Pergo? Is there anything about his style that you're worried about, or what are your feelings going into this fight on Sunday? Do you feel confident?
Yes, I feel very confident. I don't know what to say about Pergo. All I know is that he's a southpaw, and that he fought a couple of people that I have fought. Some say that, you know, he won't go the distance with me. Some say that, you know, he'll take my title from me. As far as I'm concerned, you know, I have fought southpaws before, and this is nothing new to me. I fought the best. Marvin Johnson is the best southpaw I've ever fought. Right. So therefore, I'm saying that, you know, I'm not taking too much credit from Pergo. He may give me a hard task in this championship fight, in which, you know, that's for him to please the people, the fans. But I know my job, and I know what I have to do. So I would say, hey, perhaps he's a legitimate type of contender for me.
Right. You're confident, but not overconfident.
No, I'm not.
Right. Is Pergo, is he known as being a boxer or a knockout man? What is he, or does he have a reputation for either?
I don't know the statistics of what type of style Pergo has. I know that he's a southpaw, and I know what I do with southpaws, and let's see that it work on him come May 11th.
Well, we wish you best of luck on that one, and I hope you're not only successful on Sunday, but you're successful in ultimately uniting the title, which is now split. I'm interested in, as we said at the top of the show, this is the very first world championship fight that's ever been held in Nova Scotia. Can you tell us something about how the fight came to be held in Nova Scotia? I guess you would have some say in that, eh?
Yes, I would. You know, it's a coincidence that here I was going to take my vacation in Canada. And, you know, all praise is due to Allah that when the promoter, Bob Arum, came up to me and asked me that, would you like to fight in Canada? Well, it was led down by him through my manager named Bilal Muhammad. He asked me, did I want to fight in Canada? I said, hey, you know, that's good because I wanted to take my vacation there. So that's how I think the fight got really here, because it had to come and ask the champion. And I'm very pleased here in Canada, in Nova Scotia, and I really like it. I'm being very happy, and I'm being very pleased.
Right. I guess you've been here about 2 days now. You came in on the weekend. Have you had a chance to get around to visit any of the black communities in the province? And
yes, I have.
Meet the people?
Yes, I have, and they treat me very warm, and I feel very good here once again because the people, the attitude they're taking upon me as a man.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, I guess perhaps if you're coming to Canada, it's only appropriate that you should come to Halifax to have your fight. Halifax, I think, as you probably know, has a reputation as being the fight capital of Canada. We've had many great fighters who've come out of Halifax. I don't think we've had some world champions who've come out of Halifax. Indeed, we haven't had a title fight here, mind you, but we've had several. I think one great light heavyweight that would be known perhaps to you is Sam Langford out of Weymouth, a black man from Weymouth who was very prominent at the turn of the century. So it's only appropriate that coming to Canada, that you should come to Halifax, and I'm sure all of viewers of Black Horizons join me in welcoming you to our city. I want to move away now from Matthew Muhammad the fighter and talk about a little bit about Matthew Muhammad the man. And I think it's only appropriate that we begin with the name. Your full name, brother, as I understand it, is Matthew Saad Muhammad.
Yes.
Could you tell us something about your name?
Okay. I won't go too long into this story because I have a very interesting story. You know, like I said, I was an orphan at one time. So these nuns that found me, okay, on a street, as it was called, Benjamin Franklin Park, okay.
This would be in Philadelphia.
This is in Philadelphia, yes. Okay. And when they found me, they named me Matthews and Franklin. They said, with these two names, you'll go and you'll have success, because they took the name out of the Bible, Matthews, and they gave the name in which they found me on the street, Franklin.
Right.
Okay. So that's when I started. You know, I went into schools and I've gotten into trouble and things like this. So as I got older and mature, I said, hey, you know, Italians have Italians names, Jews have Jews names. So I was figuring, why am I the only one to have a funny name like a Franklin? I noticed that a lot of Caucasians has names like a Franklin, a Bob, a Bill, a Shoe, a Lace. But then I was saying, that can't be my culture. And that's when I changed my name, and I was saying, well, I have to have a culture. Because I don't think that if I was in an airport and someone would holler out, is Mr. Handkerchief is in the presence, would like to report to the desk or something like that, you know, you would know perhaps maybe that would be a Caucasian name, but if they say Muhammad or Shabazz or something like that, you will recognize that culture as being a Bilalian. And when I say Bilalian, I mean a black person, okay? So this is the only reason why truly that I changed my name, besides of being in the religion of Islam.
You're a Muslim, right?
And yes.
Perhaps this might be appropriate to comment on the name Saad Muhammad. I understand that these two names also have very special meanings.
Yes, and being that I have changed my name, I changed it to Saad Muhammad. I kept the name Matthews, okay, and I got rid of the name Franklin,
right.
Okay? Like I said, once again, of the culture. So Matthews mean the chosen one in
right.
the Bible, so that's a very good name.
Right.
And Saad means bright future.
Right.
And, and then you have Muhammad, worthy of praise, praiseworthy. Here, being a celebrity, people look up to me, so I think that's a very good name. And Saad, meaning bright future, here already having the light heavyweight championship.
Right. All praises to Allah.
All praises to Allah.
I'd like to talk to you a bit about your involvement with the American and the Muslim Missionary Society. I want to go on and talk a bit about the society itself a little later, but before I do that, I guess the question that most people might have in their minds is, you grew up in America, most of your experiences, of course, by virtue of being a black man in America, probably would have been Christian-oriented.
Mm-hmm.
How was it that you come to embrace Islam? How did you get exposed to Islam?
Here again, I have to go back into my younger days, because all this started when I was young, and I had to really change myself over as step by step. This is when I was in being confined in a reform school, I started learning Islam. I was involved in Christianity, and I felt as though that Islam was the only best route for me to take, because I started looking through the Bible and seeing a lot of misinterpretations and things like this. And then I found this book, which is the Quran. Okay, and I think that's the only book that hasn't really been touched, okay, far as misinterpretations in it. And that's when I started studying Islam, and I'm very relaxed with Islam, and I think that is the most purest religion up to date.
Now, a lot of people in this part of the country, indeed in North America, in referring to Muslims, blacks who've joined Islam in the United States, have referred to the group as Black Muslims. Is this the proper name? Has the organization ever...
We shouldn't deal with Black Muslims, because see, at one time, I think it was like a racial, it was a very racial type of set during the time of the 60s and the 50s, because I think we was all racial. It was once called the Nation of Islam. And even you had people back in those times, the KKK, you know, Ku Klux Klans, and
yeah.
It was very racial. So, you know, this is why perhaps maybe we had called ourselves the Black Muslims. But
did you ever call, did the members of the Nation
no.
of Islam, it was called, was that a name that was given to you, or is that a name that people projected on you, the racist
people,
North American society?
Yeah, people projected that type of set on us.
Right.
Okay, and they said that, and that's when a lot of people started picking it up. But they... When I say they, I'm talking about the Caucasian society started projecting the Black Muslims.
Right, because they saw a lot of people who were black who hadn't belonged
yes.
to this particular group, and coming from the racial background that they came from, they automatically began to project the name Black Muslim.
That's right.
Quite apart from, it was irrespective of what you were calling yourselves, which was a Nation of Islam. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Excuse me, I was just going to say very briefly, I was going to say that we shouldn't deal on colors, because
yeah.
here, you know, black is when we was child, we was being taught on black colors.
Right, right.
You know, like I was saying in the conference before, you know, a guy said that I was black. I said, I'm not black. I said, I'm Bilalian. You're not white. You're Caucasian. And he pretty much picked up on a lot of things I was saying
right.
about colors. So we shouldn't get into colors saying black and white.
Right. I just want to raise that point because I think it's important to clarify, because a lot of people, when we talk about Muslims, particularly Muslims from the United States who happen to be black, a lot of people refer to them as black Muslims, and I thought it would be educational for people to know the kind of history. So it really was known as the Nation of Islam, and now I understand the organization has undergone another change, and the organization is now called the American Muslims Missionaries.
Yes.
And when did this change?
Well, it changed several weeks ago. The leader of that set is Wardif D. Muhammad, whose former name was Wallace D. Muhammad.
Right.
And it was once called the Nation, the World Community of Al-Islam.
Right.
And the reason why I feel as though he has changed the name of the religion is because of, you know, we're here in America and we're Americans, you know, we can't go nowhere else. So therefore, we have a mission to do, we have a job to do, and as being Muslim here in America, is to bring along with us all the Caucasians as well as all the Bilalians to unify ourselves in dignity and respect.
Right, and that's really the point, that your organization is not an organization that is solely for blacks. Your organization is for anybody who wants to embrace the religion of Islam.
That's a fact.
And that's an important message for people to get across, I guess.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to have time, Saad, to go on and talk a bit about the task that the American Muslim missionaries have taken for themselves, but I don't think we're going to have time in this particular program. And I don't want to get too far away from Matthew Saad Muhammad, the man. You embrace Islam. You say that that Islam has been the answer for you. What kind of effect has the fact that you've embraced Islam had on your life? How has it changed your life?
Okay, I think that it changed my life physically and mentally, because if it wasn't for Al-Islam, I wouldn't have been who I am today. Because I started getting very serious in religion. If, you know, before I was involved in Al-Islam or the American Muslim
missionaries,
yes, because it's a new name.
New name, we all have to get used to that one, yes.
We have to get used to it.
Right.
That I started seeking in the Bible. This is where it started from, in the Bible.
Right.
And I started reading all the prophecies and right on down, and I looked through that and I looked at the Quran, and I see the Quran is more powerful than the Bible. Okay. Mm-hmm. And that's when I started getting my mind together, and I can really say truthfully that Islam helped me as far as conditioning, you know, not being very wild out on the streets or things like that. I guess mostly people do things like that once they get very serious in religion, period. But it has helped me mentally.
Good. You were using, as we were talking, you were using the term Bilalians. This may not be a term that's familiar to a lot of the viewers of the Black Horizons program. Could you explain the origins of the word Bilalian? This is a name that is being used to refer to members of the...
Bilalian, you know, we use the word Bilalian, which is meaning of black people, okay, because as it was once called, a man by the name of Bilal, okay, he was the caller, the Adam, and Adam meaning someone who is the person who may tell everyone to pray or something like that, okay? Mm. And it's a word used for basically I have to take my time with
the
word Bilal, because see, it's very, very deep. I may not be very knowledgeable about going into the statistics of speaking about Bilal, but I know that it means a black person. I know that it's a person's culture.
Right. When we were talking before, we were talking about Bilal. As I understand it, Bilal was an Ethiopian who was a slave who became very close to Prophet Muhammad.
Yes. You may be more than me.
And as I understand the story, this brother became the first person in Islam to call people to salat, to prayer, and he would sing out because of his beautiful voice, and he became very close to Prophet Muhammad.
That's right.
And of course, because of his closeness to Prophet Muhammad, some thought that he might even succeed Prophet Muhammad after his death. And I guess that this name Belial, after this man Belial, who was Ethiopian, a black man from Africa, us being people who are descendants from Africa, we would take this name of Belalian.
That's right.
Right. We only have a few minutes left in the program, Matthew, so unfortunately we're not going to have time to go. There's so many things that I find you a very exciting person. There's so many things I'd like to go into to talk to you about. But if you were going to give advice to a young person, the young person came up to you and said, Matthew, I saw you on the Black Horizons program. It looks as though you've really got your life together. You've embraced Islam. That's obviously had an impact on your life. I'm kind of confused about, you know, what I should do with my kind of life and so on. What about this thing called Islam? What advice would you give to them?
Well, the advice that I would give to people is, first of all, I'm going to put it out like this. You know, they should become a somebody. It doesn't have to be a dope pusher or anything like that. As long as they strive in the right path of being someone reckoned in the society. But as far as religion, I think everyone should get into religion, because I think we Americans and throughout the world should get into religion, because I think that it will help the society more better. And I think it's about time that everybody unite and try to, you know, find themselves, okay? And that's what I would say as far as religion.
Right. One final question. You're still a young man. You've got a lot of, you're young, you're strong, you still have a lot of fights left. Perhaps this is not the most appropriate time to be talking about your career, because probably at this point you don't know just when you're going to finish in boxing. But have you given any thought to what you'll do after your boxing career is over?
Well, to tell you the truth, I don't want to really have a long boxing career. My job is only, like I said, propagating the faith. This is why I'm here today, okay? I'm propagating the faith, and I want to put this title together and then get out of boxing. I have a corporation. I have other things going good for myself. Mm-hmm. I have money put away, so I don't have to really fight. But as I will complete my goal, okay, as unifying the title together. That's the WBC and the WBA, which Eddie Gregory has now. Okay, I will then perhaps sit on the side and perhaps go into some other type of real estate or businesses like that. But I feel as though that while I'm here, I can tell the world that Al-Islam is the one.
Right. Well, Matthew, we've unfortunately run out of time. I want to wish you the best of luck in your not only in your upcoming fight, indeed with your whole career. I hope you will be successful in uniting the title and making it so that you'll become the heavyweight champion, as Muhammad Ali would say, of the whole the light heavyweight champion of the whole world.
Of the whole world.
That's the time for our Black Horizons program today. If you want to check the fight out, once again, it's Sunday, May 11th at 3 o'clock at Metro Center. I understand tickets are still available. That's our program for today. Thank you for watching. See you next time. Hello, welcome to Black Horizons. I'm your host, Hamid Rasheed. Our guest on today's program is Al Mercury of Toronto. Al is the Executive Secretary of the National Black Coalition of Canada. Many viewers of the Black Horizons program will recall that we had Al on our program, I think it was in October of last year, Al, just after you had been appointed Executive Secretary of the National Black Coalition of Canada. I understand, however, that you're in Nova Scotia this weekend on other matters than the National Black Coalition of Canada. Would you tell us what's brought you to our fair province this time?
Yes, that's right. I've been invited here by your local Preston Lions Club as their guest speaker at their third charter anniversary. I'm a past district governor of Lions International, and I'm pleased to be a guest speaker at the second Black Lions Club in Canada.
I understand, just before we go on and talk to you a little bit about NBCC affairs, I understand that your Lions Club, or the Lions Club that you're now affiliated with in Toronto, was the first Black Lions Club, is that right?
Yes, they were. They're 7 years old now, and I'm very happy, and I was honored to be their charter president. Mm-hmm. But the club seems to be thriving, and I'll be quite frank about it, it's a pleasure for us to see, as it were, additional blacks joining the world family of Lionism.
Okay, well, I wish you best of luck during your speaking engagement with the Lions, and the best of luck to the East Preston Lions clubs themselves. I want to go on now, Al, and talk to you a little bit about your activities these last 6 or 7 months as Executive Secretary of the National Black Coalition of Canada. I understand you've been extremely busy doing a number of things, fundraising, carrying out a needs assessment, involving yourself in some of the local community issues there in Toronto. I'd like to talk, first of all, about the needs assessment that you carried out. Would you tell us something about the assessment, what you were attempting to do, and what the results of the study were?
Well, the entire executive committee of the National Black Coalition of Canada worked on this needs assessment study. What it entailed was their visiting the various black communities across the country, including your own Halifax, and getting firsthand knowledge via questionnaires and discussions as to what the actual needs of the communities were. We found a surprising unanimity in the needs, and the biggest problem we had was attempting to prioritize those needs.
Right. Now, the assessment, the needs assessment project now is concluded. You've gotten the results back. What is the intention of the organization, in as much as the feedback that you've gotten? What are you planning to do now with the...
Well, now that we have the needs assessment study, we have now created an action plan based directly on the needs assessment study, and we now know in which directions we're going. Our first priority is in the field of education. Mm-hmm. A second priority is, or I shouldn't say a second really, because I would call it rather an additional priority, is in the field of affirmative action as far as employment is concerned. And here, incidentally, we feel that the various provincial governments and the federal government must take the lead. And another equally important area is social or human rights action as far as giving people of visible minorities opportunities, not only in the employment area, but within every milieu of our society in the various institutions. And I might add that there's a tremendous groundswell of need, particularly amongst the young people. And this is something that we have found right across the country.
Right. I perhaps should have taken the time at the beginning of the program to point out that you are the first full-time executive secretary in the history of the National Black Coalition of Canada. Is that correct?
Yes, that's true. I mean,
the National Black Coalition has been operating for how many years now, roughly?
10 years, roughly. It started in 1969.
Right.
And it was inactive for a couple of years. It was in a state of hiatus, really, suspended animation, because of internal problems. But we think we've got those internal problems pretty well solved now. And we now have two full-time employees. There's myself, and we have an administrative secretary within the office who does the actual typing and paperwork that has to be done.
Right. I understand you're now occupying the old offices, the old Contrast newspaper magazine office in Toronto.
Well, we're a tenant of theirs, actually. Yeah. We're upstairs from where Contrast is.
I see. They're still in the building.
They're still in the building.
Right. At the annual meeting of the National Black Coalition held here in Halifax last year, a very successful meeting from all the indications that I have, there was quite a bit of discussion on the question of funding. The organization set a budget, and there was an indication that a substantial amount of funding for the organization was going to be sought from the private community as opposed to government. What have you been able to do in this area of funding since the annual meeting here?
Well, we've been partially successful. Of course, you're never successful in fundraising to the extent that you hope you will be. But what we've done is we've essentially taken the history and the past, or I should say the past history, as well as our particular aims and objectives to the business community. And we've put it on a very business-like basis. There's a four-page brochure that outlines our background, our goals, and how we intend to raise funds. And we've had some response from the business communities, from firms such as Shell Oil, the various banking institutions. We've had some assistance from Plura, which is the Presbyterian, Lutheran, United, Roman Catholic, and Anglican churches. They've been good enough to give us a grant. We're still awaiting word from the federal government as to whether they're going to give us some assistance. But basically, we hope within the next 3 or 4 years to become self-sustaining through not only memberships, but also with the assistance through annual appeals to the business community as a whole. Because we feel that what we're doing, after all, is for the good of not just the black portion of society, but for society as a whole. And we feel they should have an input, and it is not necessarily just a financial one. We do accept non-blacks as members, and we have quite a few who are members.
Right. How have you structured yourself to facilitate the fundraising activity? For example, in the regions, if there's somebody who may be viewing the program today who might want to make a contribution to the NBCC, how would they go about it?
Well, the easiest way to go about it, as far as that is concerned, would be to send a contribution directly, and incidentally, it's tax deductible, mm-hmm. to the National Black Coalition of Canada, Post Office Box 7200, Postal Station B, Willowdale, Ontario.
Okay, well, there may be people in the audience who may wish to make a donation. You mentioned in passing about membership's contribution to fundraising. What is the state of affairs as far as membership is going? I understand you've developed a new constitution which sets out new criteria for admission. How are things going with membership, and how does one become a member, and what are the various classes of membership? I've asked you several questions there, I realize.
Right, maybe I can answer them all with one fell swoop, Hamid. Yeah. There are three basic classes of membership. There is one class which is on a group basis, where a group can become what we call a member in coalition. That is, they are a group that's doing their own thing, but they subscribe to our philosophy and feel they can live within the tenets of our constitution. They then apply to become a group in coalition, and they do that by sending an application to the same post office box I described, to myself. And that should contain a list of their members. It should also contain a notification of the motion where they approved the applying to us for a group in coalition status. And the annual fee is $2 per year per member, which they pay in bulk. They then become a group in coalition and are under the umbrella of the NBCC. Then there is yet a second group situation where a group of individuals, and there must be a minimum of 10, apply to become a duly chartered chapter of the National Black Coalition of Canada, mm-hmm. in which case they come under the chapter constitution of the National Black Coalition of Canada. Mm-hmm. And the fee for that is $10 per member annually. But then they have the option of utilizing NBCC's name and all the prerogatives that name and privilege bestows in their own efforts at doing things within the community, which means they would become a civil rights or human rights oriented group in their own right within their particular locale.
Just be like chapters in the
right, a chapter,
the national, or the NAA, I think it's the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People in the States.
The same concept. The same concept. They would then become a chapter. Then there's the third concept where an individual may become what we call a sustaining member. That is, he agrees with our philosophy, he or she agrees with our philosophy, but does not wish to become a member or is not able to become a member of a group in coalition, or they don't have a specific chapter in that locale. They then can join as an individual. By paying $25, they become a sustaining member. Or again, pardon me, there's yet another way. They can pay $10 and become a member of what we call the national chapter as an individual. But the point is, we feel everyone should have an opportunity to have some input into the process of change.
On the membership of the individuals, I guess this would assist people, like, for example, where there's small populations, where there's not possible to have a chapter, like people maybe from the West where the populations are small, or for that matter, anywhere, anybody who there may not be enough individuals in the area who want to form a chapter so they can become a member of the national chapter in the way that you've described.
That's right.
So they don't need to have a whole bunch of people in order to become involved with the National Black Coalition of Canada.
All the individual needs is the conviction within his own mind that he would like to see things in our society change for the better.
Right. I'd like to move on now then and talk about some of those proposed areas of change that you mentioned, growing out of your needs assessment. You mentioned some of the priorities, education, legal matters, civil and human rights, and so on. Starting off with, first of all, with the legal area, what kinds of things is the NBCC involving itself in the legal area?
Well, at present, the chairman of the legal panel, and so far there are only 8 lawyers in this legal panel, and they are in various communities across the country, and we hope to have a couple of lawyers here join that panel, but they are there to handle litigation for people whose rights have been infringed upon because they happen to be of a visible minority, and they have been taken advantage of either by an individual or a group or an institution. And these people are there to do something about it from a legal sense, and the cost will be defrayed by NBCC.
Mm-hmm. I understand at one point the legal panel, which as you've described is comprised of lawyers from across the country. Do they have a chairman, by the way?
Yes, they do. The chairman is Ms. Marva Jemmott, J-E-M-M-O-T-T.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a very brilliant practicing lawyer in Toronto, and I can assure you that she's sharp as a tack, and she's really doing a tremendous job. Just the very fact that she found the time in her busy schedule to get this number of lawyers to work together as a panel, and we do intend to keep them as active as possible.
Right. So going back to the beginning, my question I was going to ask you related to the whole question of constitutional debate. We're getting ready now, the whole country's getting ready for a summer of talks around the Constitution. I understand that there was some discussion with this lawyers panel about preparing a position paper from the black perspective. Is that being pursued, or?
I understand that paper is under preparation, but I have had no opportunity to get any insight into what it may contain. Although personally, I feel it's long overdue. I don't think that the two, what I would call, cultures who are arguing about who is the founding nation are really taking a true look at the picture. At least 1/3 of the population in this country is neither French nor English, and I feel we too have an input because, after all, it is our future that is being decided, as well as their own.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let's move on then to the area of education. I understand from reading the media from Upper Canada that there's recently been a group of black educators that has been formed in Toronto. Is there any coalition or any connection between that group and the National Black Coalition of Canada?
I understand from their president, who I was speaking with last week, he came into the office, that they will be making application to get the status of a group in coalition with NBCC. Mm-hmm. They are at present undergoing the throes of organization themselves. They already number over 130 educators, and I understand that they're really heavily involved right now in putting their own house in order,
right.
And then I have no doubt that we'll probably be hearing from them early in the fall.
Right. Over and above this Alliance of Black Educators, what other kinds of things are being contemplated and or taking place in the area of education as far as the NBCC is concerned?
Well, we're also, in Toronto, we have gotten involved very heavily in getting entree to a junior college for blacks who left school prematurely. And when I say prematurely, I mean they left school before they wanted to, through no fault of their own, or they may have left because they felt that the halls of academia were not for them.
Mm-hmm.
We have a situation where deserving people can be subsidized if they so desire, and their education can be upgraded to the point where they can attend an institution where they can learn a trade or a skill to make them qualified for the job market. In my considered opinion, and I was 20 years in the employment business, I think the greatest hindrance to a full employment for most blacks is the problem that many of them are simply not qualified.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to do something about this tremendous wastage of humanity.
Mm-hmm. In the area of civil and human rights, I know there's been a lot of discussion, a lot of talk about the situation involving the police in the Toronto area. Many people in this province are aware of the tragic killings that took place last year, I guess, with the shooting of the Evans boy and then the later shooting of Johnson, I believe it was.
Mm-hmm. Albert Johnson.
How is that situation working itself out now in the Toronto area, and what is the NBCC's involvement, if any, in the area of police community relations?
Well, the NBC has been extremely heavily involved in the area of police community relations. One of the problems has been that many of the officials at the civic level won't admit that there really is a problem. And their contention, and we've been faced with this statement many times by the Metro chairman and various so-called responsible officials, that 80% of the people are satisfied with the police force as it is presently constituted. Now, my rebuttal to that is, that's like saying 8 of your 10 fingers are functioning, so you don't worry about the 2 that are hurting.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, you need all 10 fingers to function properly. So although you treasure the 8 that are working, you want to take care of the 2 that are hurting as well.
Mm-hmm.
And quite frankly, the police community relations are not improving to any great extent. Most of the changes that have been made are purely cosmetic. One of the things we have brought to the attention of the authorities is the fact that blacks have been on the Toronto Police Force now for 20 years. None has gone beyond the point of sergeant. And unless you can get into the commissioned ranks, very like the Army, you're not in the decision-making process.
Mm-hmm.
You're an individual who then carries out, but you don't have any input into policy. Now, in rebuttal to that, since they've appointed a new chief of police who has recently taken office in Toronto, they have advanced one visible minority, and I use that word because he is not black, to the status of staff sergeant, which again, that's not where the action is, but it's a step in the right direction.
Apart from this question of mobility within the police department, what about access to the police department and the level of black constables on the Metro Police Force. Is the situation in Toronto similar to the situation we find here in Metro and in other areas across the country, where the number of blacks on the force are very minimal?
Well, part of
getting people on the force.
Well, part, yes, they do. They've just changed the recruiting policy on the Toronto Police Force, where they have waived the height and weight requirements. In other words, you no longer have to be 5 feet 10 or 5 feet 9 1/2 or whatever it was. I didn't pay too much attention to it because it didn't affect me.
That's because you're a tall person.
That may well be. But part of the problem has been why they haven't been recruiting blacks and other visible minorities is the perception in which the police department is viewed. And this is what I have submitted this to the chief of police, that the fact is blacks do not see the police department as a career opportunity. While it may be a fair-paying job, because most of the constables in Toronto are now getting $24,000 a year, it may be a good-paying job, but once you adapt policing as a career, unfortunately, it doesn't just become a career, it becomes a way of life. Police become your companions day and night. You and your wife associate only with other policemen's families, et cetera, and it goes on ad infinitum. And I think that's part of the problem. The police become walled off from the rest of society, and they have their own society, and everybody else to them is an outsider. It becomes them and us. And that's exactly what's taking place, and it shows in the confrontations which they have, not only with the black segment of society, but with society as a whole.
Well, certainly room for improvement in that particular area. Another area I want to touch on before we move this area is the activities that have been taking place to try to get an independent complaint bureau to investigate complaints against the police in Metro. Could you tell us what progress you're having with that?
Well, we've had some pretty tough sledding, I can tell you. Quite frankly, last week, this legislation to create a so-called independent complaint bureau, although it really wasn't, was defeated in the provincial parliament. As you know, in Ontario we have a minority government, and the two other parties simply defeated it. And quite frankly, the black community was delighted that it was defeated, because it still had a problem with the bill. And the basic problem was that it was founded on the basic concept that the police would still investigate police. And as a black, as a citizen, and a concerned individual of the community, I must say I protested most vehemently, not only in my official capacity, but as a citizen in the community, because it simply won't wash.
That is police investigating.
Police investigating police. It just won't wash. Because their credibility is just not that strong within the black community.
What are your plans now in terms of the bill is gone, it's been defeated? What are your hopes in this regard in terms of trying to set up this independent commission? Do you have any definite plans in terms of how you'll approach the issue now that the bill is defeated?
Well, we're hoping that we can bring to their attention the model that's being used in Chicago. And we have pointed this out to the Attorney General of Ontario, Mr. McMurtry, that there is a system working in Chicago that seems eminently satisfactory not only to the citizens but to the police as well, where they have what they call a Bureau of Public Safety, and that bureau is manned by civilians, and they have independent investigators who are ex-policemen, etc., but they're not policemen per se, and they're not perceived by the public as policemen. His rebuttal to that has been that it's still in the experimental stage. Well, I pointed out to him the system he wanted to implement in Toronto has been tried in England, and it was unsuccessful. So I have no reason to believe that it would be successful if it were transplanted to this side of the Atlantic.
Right. So as I understand it, the concept in the bill that was defeated was that the things would remain pretty much as they are now, except that there would be a commissioner who, after the police had had a chance to deal with it, would have a look at it. So that really all you're doing is you're adding one more step, but you still have the police involved in the first instance, which might prevent people from coming forward and making complaints.
Well, that was one part of it that was different, but the other part that was different was that they had created a panel of 15 civilians, 5 to be appointees of the police association, who were proposed by the police association, 5 to be proposed by the police commission, and 5 to be proposed by the Metro Council. And of these 15 people, 5 of them had to have legal training, so that if the investigation proved that it should go to a panel, there would be one individual on these little committees from each of these 3 segments. The one with the legal training would be automatically chairman, and they would investigate this thing. And I'll tell you, it was very nice in theory,
but
it was pretty cumbersome and pretty complex, and it was calculated, really, as far as I'm concerned, to perpetuate the system that's already in existence.
Right. Well,
to protect the police.
I hope that you'll be successful with implementing some of the other more viable alternatives that are available. We only have a couple minutes left in the program, and there are a couple of other areas that I want to move off of this area to another related question, I guess, and that is the recognizing, of course, that the NBCC for the first time has an executive secretary, and it takes a while for the organization to get established, and it takes a while for the organization to kind of develop the capability. What do you see, like I've gathered from a lot of the remarks you've made, that there's a high concentration of activity in the metro area. What do you see as being the potential for more direct contact with other regions of the country in the future? Or is that a role that the NBCC is contemplating playing?
Well, I must point out to you that I spoke only of the metro area,
right,
because the very problems that we have in metro, we have ascertained our microcosm of the problems that are taking place, surprisingly enough, right across the country. Mm-hmm. The same problem we have with police in Toronto exists with police in Vancouver, in Winnipeg, in Ottawa, in Hamilton, and I dare say probably exists in your own community. Mm-hmm. So it's not an isolated problem. And in my considered opinion, NBC will take a leadership role in bringing to the attention not of just one individual attorney general, but the attorneys general of the provinces who meet regularly, the fact that it is a universal problem, and to the Ontario, at least the Canadian Association of Police Chiefs, that it is a universal problem, and we intend to combat it and let these people who are in authority know, as well as the legislators.
Right. So it's not necessarily then the intention of the National Black Coalition to try to be everything in the area of service delivery to the black community in Canada. You don't see as being the role of NBCC to be necessarily directly involved in particular disputes in the regions, but more or less to try to deal with the broader policy issues, try to deal with these problems at the macro level so that the solution can be brought about that way.
Exactly. We intend to attack it at the macro level or at the national level, and it will filter down to the various areas from there, hence the reason why we say we would welcome more groups in coalition and more chapters in more places.
We only have 1 minute left, and I want to just tuck on this question of coalitions with the larger community. What has the NBCC been able to do in this particular area, that is, with other national organizations from other visible minority communities? Has there been any involvement in this area?
Yes, we have.
We only have about a minute, so.
Okay, we've made contact. And the last time we made representation to the province, we went to see the premier of the province, and we had representation from the Jewish community, the Italian community, the East Asian community, and the Chinese community with ourselves. And we met 5 cabinet ministers and the premier for 2.5 hours. So I can tell you that we are being listened to. But this is the way we have to go in order to attain our goals. We're all in the same boat.
Al, I want to thank you very much for being our guest on the Black Horizons program today. Unfortunately, we've exhausted our time for the program. Sounds very much as though you're getting very involved in your capacity as the Executive Secretary of the National Black Coalition. I want to wish you the best in all of your activities, and we trust you'll enjoy your stay in Nova Scotia. That's our program for the day. Thank you very much for watching Black Horizons. See you next time.